DJ Tony Drake.
This is DJ Tony Drake, a.k.a. Mr. Top Shelf himself, and right now, you're in tune to Your World News, where journalism and activism are not mutually exclusive, here on yourworldnews.org.
This is an appeal to our sisters and brothers, sons and daughters of Africa who are great actors and actresses. So don't get it twisted. That means those of you who call yourselves great African Americans.
Those of you who act either on television, sitcoms, or dramas, movies, or in Broadway productions. This includes those of you who work behind the scenes as writers, directors, producers, choreographers, camera women, and men.
We are asking that from now on, you refuse to play the following roles and characters: police officers, military officers, and intelligence agents.
Any part of the U.S. military, industrial, intelligence, police complex. This means U.S. Homeland Security.
Whenever you play these roles, this is a message that you are not concerned about police terrorism against African people. This includes U.S. Africa policy and the raping and plundering of Mother Africa.
This includes U.S. foreign policy, which brings two words to mind: seek and destroy.
Didn't Dr. King say the United States was the greatest purveyor for violence on earth? Is this country more violent in 2016 than in 1967 when we initially made the statement?
We feel some of you agree with us. You just haven't spoken up, haven't taken a stand. These atrocities are nothing new.
War criminals and terrorists like Bull Connor, Jim Clark, William Parker, Frank Renzo, and J. Edgar Hoover are household names for a reason. This country thinks it's their God-given right to police the world.
Why is there a blockade on Cuba? Why are there sanctions on Zimbabwe and Venezuela?
Dropping bombs is just as common for the U.S. government as burning crosses on our yards was for the Ku Klux Klan. Because of U.S. imperialism, some of our bravest warriors were taken from us far too soon.
The assassination of Brother Malcolm and Dr. King were just drops in the bucket. Remember Patrice Lumumba in the Congo, Mohamed Mossadegh in Iran, or Jacobo Arbenz from Guatemala.
We know some of you have relatives that are police officers, military officers, and intelligence agents
that claim to be respectable, therefore are outraged by the trail of blood that police officers, the U.S. military, and intelligence agencies have left all over the world.
This history is exactly why, under any circumstances, we can never play these roles again.
This appeal will provide the individuals a safety net because they are not in the position to condemn the atrocities like we can.
How many dictators throughout history, all over Africa, Asia, the Caribbean, and Latin America, has the United States given unconditional support?
What was the reason for bombing Libya 7 months in a row?
You have no right to spread confusion and compromise our future.
Who dropped the atomic bomb on Hiroshima and bombed the headquarters of the MOVE organization in Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love?
Countless war crimes and acts of terrorism have been committed by the U.S. government in the name of democracy, God, and human rights.
Isn't the Zionist state of Israel your creation?
Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles. Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles.
Don't play these roles.
No matter how much money you are offered.
When I watched this film again, Obi had sent it to me some time ago when we talked about this evening. And I watched it a couple of times, and watching it here again, it touches me at a level that's really very deep. And touched me at a level, in spite of the fact that I'm 64 years old, and I think that I try to work every day on my maturity and on my impulse control, work on my anger management. As I sat there, I felt my fist balling up more and more. And the one of the very serious redeeming qualities of that film is the power that I see, is the power and the impact that when you put in the hands of young people, of young black people, the ability to be able to create something like the film you just saw, that is something that has the potential to stay with them for the rest of their lives and to guide them on a path towards being liberators. I interviewed today Kathy Hughes, which is going to be coming on the Rock Newman Show in 7 minutes on WHUT. And I talked to her about leadership and saying that the most important role, the most crucial role in the human experience is that of a mother. And because she was a single mother, so you know, so we talked about that. The great challenge and opportunity is for a mother or a father, for a teacher, to teach youngsters to think. By and large, we are in a serious system of indoctrination, which says, read this thing here that George Washington never told a lie, chopped down a cherry tree, and Thanksgiving, and Columbus discovered America. And Dick Gregory said, Columbus discovering America was like you coming in my house trying to eat my watermelon. So it's a powerful piece. I hope that it some kind of way finds widespread distribution. As I said to you there, send me that again. It's in 10 million emails or text messages, Facebook ago, and I'd have to scroll. So the easiest thing is send it to me again, because I have no idea why I neglected to forward it and put it onto my YouTube channel, which is a fairly significant form of distribution for me now. Because I want everybody who watches the Rock Newman Show, whether it's on WHUT, they find it some other way, or the Rock Newman Show YouTube channel, have an opportunity to see that. I think it has that kind of impact. One, very much congratulations, Obi, for putting in the kind of work that would allow your students to guide them in a way that would help them produce something like that and to take those initial steps to becoming lifelong liberators. Big ups to you for that, brother.
Well, thank you. We're honored to be with you again. It's been 3 years, and we've been busy since then. Well, in all actuality, the credit should go to Ross F. and C.A. Lee Wright. Brother Ross F. is 15 years old, and his sister is 12 years old. And they already won an award for Best Children's Documentary at a film festival in Seattle earlier this year that they had produced about a friend of theirs who is growing, two friends of theirs, who are also in our children's history and theater company, Mass Emphasis, Zion UC, who's 16 years old, and his brother Yende, who's 10, whose father passed away 1 month before mine. And so they felt compelled to do that. So what had happened in all actuality was we had just come from Muhammad University of Islam doing the play that we did called The Fighting Spirit Lives On. So when I got back in the house, I got like 30 phone calls and 40 emails from people all over the country, because this was right after what happened in Dallas and New Orleans. So I told them that I wanted to talk with them, because one of the advantages of living in DC is people on the national level reach out to you to get an idea of how we have brainstormed to deal with the countless challenges that we face as Africans, home and abroad. And so what ended up happening is I met with Rasef, and I asked him how he felt about what was going on. And he said that he was torn, because he really didn't know what to do, but he wanted to do something. So I told him, well, we need to get our weapons together. So he looked at me, and I said, I mean your skills and your talents. So we sat there, we spent time that weekend together, and that's when we came up with what you just finished watching. Now, for us, the strategic importance of that coming from children, not just in relationship to their sector, there are a couple of things we want people to look at. Number one, the historical moment. This year is pregnant with history, as we shall say. This year is the 50th anniversary of Kwame Ture and Mukasa Dada shouting Black Power in Greenwood, Mississippi, first propagated by Richard Wright 12 years before that in his book that he dedicated to Kwame Nkrumah, first propagated by Frederick Douglass so long ago. This is the 50th anniversary of the second or third Black Panther Party in Oakland, California for self-defense. This is the 50th anniversary of the overthrow of Osagyefo Kwame Nkrumah on February 24th, 1966, which happened at the same time that the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad was meeting with Dr. King at his home in Chicago. This is the 30th anniversary of the mysterious plane crashing of Mozambique's first president, Samora Machel, October 19th, 1986. This is the 40th anniversary of the Soweto Uprising, and the 25th anniversary of Africans on the continent celebrating the Day of the African Child. So, which Soweto Day for them was the day that they strategically picked. Now, for us also, it was very strategic that this came from children based in Washington, D.C., which without question is the surveillance capital of not just the United States, but the entire planet, what Christians call God's green earth. Anybody who moves around in the District of Columbia knows that you will see your regular Metropolitan Police Department, Park Police have unlimited jurisdiction, you have Capitol Hill Police, you have the DEA, you have the FBI, you have the CIA, you now even have library police, and of course you have the Pentagon. So we are surrounded. That represents where we are. And always using history as our guide. When we were talking earlier about the deportation of the Honorable Marcus Mosiah Garvey, it was a retired Metropolitan Police officer named Herbert Bowman who worked with J. Edgar Hoover and under the direction of J. Edgar Hoover infiltrated the Universal Negro Improvement Association African Communities League to set up the Honorable Marcus Mosiah Garvey on mail fraud charges, which that still needs to be resolved. We know that the FBI and CIA, not the Nation of Islam, assassinated Malcolm X in cold blood, but the New York Police Department set up the Bureau of Special Services, which was a bureau that in conjunction with the FBI and CIA kept a file on Brother Malcolm. And we know that everywhere Dr. King and the Southern Christian Leadership Conference and the Montgomery Improvement Association prior to that did organizing in the South, every one of those police departments had a dossier on him. So when we take a look at that tradition, we felt that we were obligated historically out of Washington, D.C. to do a video of that sort with that type of focus and that type of concentration. We also took into consideration that you have to deal with the historical divide that we have on the question of the military industrial intelligence police complex, which we've always had as a people. Thurgood Marshall felt it was his patriotic duty to turn over to the New York branch of the FBI a file on Robert Williams, who, when he was the president of the Monroe chapter of the NAACP, felt that we needed to defend ourselves with arms. Jackie Robinson felt it was his patriotic duty to attack Paul Robeson when he was brought before the House of Un-American Activities Committee. And Jackie Robinson also felt patriotically obligated to be the first one in our community to condemn Muhammad Ali for refusing to go to Vietnam. So we know that in the past, when we deal with this question of police terrorism as part and parcel of the military-industrial intelligence police complex, our community is divided. But we felt that it was very important to deal with this, not only in the context of individuals, but the institutional framework that we're talking about. And lastly, before I give the mic back to you, it had an autobiographical dimension to it, because we hear certain parents are telling us, but they're good police. So we said, we'll give some examples just using our personal experience. 9 years ago, you probably remember this, a teenager in Southeast in Congress Heights was gunned down by police named Deontay Rawlins, who claimed that they saw him on their stolen scooter, and they were off duty at the time. Then they claimed that it was a shootout, but the autopsy showed that he was shot in the back of the head. So we submitted an appeal to the United Nations that we felt that police terrorism inside the United States borders was equivalent to military repression and violence under military dictators in Africa, the Caribbean, and Latin America. And the very first organization to sign on to that was Ron Hampton of the National Black Police Association. When I bump into him now, he says that got him outvoted, removed from the leadership position of that organization, deciding to do that. About 12 years ago, I used to work at Bowie State University. I used to run a dorm there. I'm not smart enough to teach college students. And the students in 2003, they had a walkout on Dr. King's assassination day. And it was right around the time when the United States had reinvaded Iraq. So students at Sojourner Douglas, when that was still open, Morgan, Coppin, and Bowie, they did the same thing at the same time. And the head of public safety, as it is called, another campus, it's called Campus Police, he sent the flyer of the teaching to Homeland Security and circled my name. And then after that, I was called. They didn't renew my contract the next year, but I received a phone call from one of the public safety officers, who said, "Brother, the FBI was already asking about you today." I said, "What?" And he said, "This is the name of the agent, and I just felt you should know that, because I watched you very carefully when you were working here, and you never did anything that qualified as terrorism under Homeland Security. So I respect what you did. So if you would have told," and the way I grew up, we called security guards or Metro Transit Police, we called them rent-a-pigs, to be honest with you. So if you would have told me that a rent-a-pig would have told me that the FBI was investigating me, and we found out the reason I was under FBI investigation, they said, because I spend a lot of time with the Cuban diplomats in Washington, D.C. So if you would have told me that the disciples of J. Edgar Hoover were after me for standing firmly with the Cuban Revolution, I'll take that all day long, all day, every day, as we say in our community. So that was just some of the background that inspired us to do this, because we feel that police terrorism and military repression and violence are not a question of legislation, are not a question of policy, but a question of the very cultural framework of the United States as we know it.
Yes, if there was a packed house in here, there should have been a standing applause. That's very powerful. It makes me think of so many things, of experiences that I've had, and to whatever extent I've been blessed with discernment. You know, if I blow my own horn at a particular point, it would be having given some knack to see championship quality before the championship becomes. You know, I will give a frame of reference. I've made a very strong declaration that I'm no longer involved in boxing. And I don't even like to see guys standing there beating up on each other anymore. It's just, it's however I've grown or softened or whatever it is, I just don't like to do that. But there was a time when, you know, those instincts were such that I knew beyond the shadow of a doubt that this young guy in Brooklyn, New York named Riddick Bowe, that given the right kind of guidance, could become the heavyweight champion of the world. So much so I knew it that I bet my financial, really, and personal life on it. That's how much I believe that I was right in understanding what talents he had and who and what he could become with the right guidance. So along the way, I'll go back and talk about Marion Barry. When Marion Barry was the most politically dead politician in the history of this country, just having got caught doing some on a pipe and saying, you know, the lady set him up, and didn't exactly say lady. Through that trauma, understanding the impact that Marion had had on the District of Columbia and the kinds of policies that he had put in place that attempted to level the playing field, and he did that in a very fearless way against with the backdrop of the overseers who were Southerners who didn't want to see anything remotely approaching equality. See, equality to the oppressor, that is a very terrorizing concept. And when they were talking about you, the terrorists, looking, what you're teaching now is indeed terrifying to the oppressor. Where I'm going with this is, I was in CERT Libya. I went there on a mission with Minister Farrakhan. His sons were good friends with the sons of Muammar Gaddafi. And they were talking about a development project that wanted to incorporate black leadership. And one of my close friends, a black developer, a Haitian brother, lives in Atlanta, speaks fluently 5 or 6 languages, and it was during a time of the Organization of African Union. So you had, I think it was 54 heads of state who were there. And I listened with headphones in ear to the translation of Muammar Gaddafi talking about his vision. And the vision to have a United States of Africa, to change the currency, to have one currency. One currency designated and supported, not designated, but supported by the minerals in the ground, which is, you know, there's nowhere else on the planet that compares with the wealth of Africa. And those instincts kicked in, and I was praying as the instincts were kicking in that I was wrong. I wanted to be wrong this time, but as I heard him speaking, that power, my instinct said, they got to take him out. Him speaking this would so change the balance of power in the world, they have to take him out. And shortly thereafter, there was a methodical, organized, vicious, ungodly plan to take him out. And which you show, which the kids show, in this film. So, again, its impact is easily felt to any conscious person here in the nation's capital. But it has worldwide, what they've done, what's been produced, has worldwide ramifications. To whoever might see this, I'll wrap this piece up before I give you back the mic, is I now forget the year, but it was just after Zimbabwe took its place in the world of countries, And Robert Mugabe came to Howard University, 1980. One of the most electrifying moments of my life, and as I talk about it right now, I get chills on my arm, remembering him talking about Howard University, talking about wanting to connect Zimbabwe and all of Africa to African Americans here in the United States, and opening up his arms very wide and inviting Africans to come home. The work that you have tirelessly done on behalf of Mugabe and Zimbabwe, I'm surprised, man, they haven't taken you up. So there is a God force that supersedes all of this. If I could just, from this, you know, with these gray hairs and whatever wisdom that might have come with it and appreciation, say to you, man, just, you know, brother, keep doing what you're doing. Because when you see these kids, these are seeds that have been planted. As Ossie Davis said, these are seeds that have been planted that are sprouting that will make a difference.
Well, thank you for covering so much. In terms of Marion Barry, I'm glad that you brought that up because I was with him in 1993 on Capitol Hill. And at that time, my sister Faye Williams working and attorney Mary Cox, they had organized under Congressman John Conyers' banner. There was supposed to be a discussion over the harassment of our elected officials in relationship to the surveillance that they were all under. But unfortunately for them, because they didn't want to push the envelope, they thought that they could get away with having a discussion with those type of parameters and restrictions. And the community said, absolutely not. There's no way that we're going to let you talk about that and not talk about the counterintelligence program. And so when we started, our brother Marion got up there and he revealed what Mary Cox through Barry Murray during the time of the Capitol Spotlight prior to News Dimensions had focused in on the fact that the FBI spent $90 million to trap him in that room. $90 million, this is 26 years ago. And it reminded people of what Adam Clayton Powell Jr. was subjected to. So, and in relationship to this question of the police, as we see these demonstrations everywhere, as we see these seminars everywhere, and we see these conferences everywhere, people forget that a mayor's relationship to the police is identical to a president's relationship to a military. So the mayors are the commanders in chief. And how come we haven't seen any of our organizations call for a meeting with the National Conference of Black Mayors at a time where we have more mayors than we've ever had in our history of being here, in our history of participating in the voter registration process? And this is, interestingly enough, I'll keep it close, Stephanie Rawlings Blake, am I saying her name correctly, in Baltimore. She's the U.S. Conference of Mayors Vice President. She was the treasurer of the Democratic National Committee. And there were rumblings that they were trying to have the Democratic National Convention in Baltimore before we made our contribution to urban architecture in response to what happened to Freddie Gray. So the fact that these mayors' loyalty is to the police and not to our people, their loyalty, and the other reason that this is important to bring up is because when we deal with this question of police terrorism and military repression and violence, it is imperative that we talk about the difference between blue-collar crime and white-collar crime. What we are subjected to, blue collar crime, is poor people's crime, desperate people's crime, hungry people's crime. White collar crime is the most wicked, richest, powerful people on the earth flexing their muscle militarily, politically, and economically. Let us just give a few examples quickly. If I snatch your iPhone right there, Brother Rock, that's a blue collar crime. And I'm going to jail because that's grand larceny. But Sprint, Motorola, AT&T, Dell, Apple can go into the Congo and strip the Congo of its coltan which is necessary to make an iPhone, an iPad, a laptop, a desktop, and no one says anything about it. You can get life for carjacking now. All cars run on tires. But yet, Firestone, whose plant is in Monrovia, the capital of Liberia, they can go into Liberia and continue to steal the rubber in abundance, and no one says anything about it. So what we have to say to our young people is, let us stop engaging in blue collar crime so we can organize ourselves to get rid of the world of white collar crime and liberate ourselves. Slavery was a white collar crime. Colonialism was a white collar crime. What is going on with our Palestinian sisters and brothers, that's white collar crime. We are against blue collar crime, but we understand the dynamics as they relate to blue collar crime, but our ultimate goal is to end white collar crime. So when the more conservative and liberal entities in our community begin to talk about blue collar crime, we'll tell them then don't become a equivalent to a character in a silent movie when we start dealing with white collar crime. And we're getting to the point where we're recognizing that white collar crime is the problem. At a moment in history where, according to Forbes magazine, there are 1,760 billionaires worth $7 trillion almost, and you have 1 billion people on earth who are hungry. At a time when in Africa, a child dies every 15 minutes from hunger. So for us, it was very important to connect these things. So we thank you for starting off with Marion Barry and then going into Libya. What many people ask me to compare the work we did as students in the 90s to what's going on with the young people today. And we won't pass any judgment on them. We won't criticize them. They are our children. But we can look at some of the things. We must ask ourselves how we saw a video of Rodney King, didn't like the way the video looked. We clenched our fists like you said you did when you watched this video. And we brought the United States to a complete halt. Yet, at a time where we're getting killed every 28 hours, we can't bring the country to a halt. And they have the assistance of HBO sitcoms, ABC sitcoms, promoting their causes. Why is that? That's what we have to ask ourselves. And also, when we go back and look at the 1990s, nobody benefited more from Rodney King, the Rodney King rebellions, than William Jefferson Clinton. The same way that Hillary Rodham Clinton is going to be the beneficiary of what these young people are doing right now. So we are confronted with the same problem. Can we become the beneficiaries of our genuine resistance? The Million Man March got Bill Clinton reelected. Because as a matter of fact, we had the honor of working on the National Youth Organizing Committee in 1995, and Ben Chavis came in and told us all we were gonna do was voter registration that summer leading up to the march. And we told him, nah, not us. There are certain people that are going to do that. We're committed to the day of absence and day of action. And even though every time people think about the Million Man March, they think about the Day of Atonement, according to the conservative estimates of the National Park Services and Newsweek magazine, 4 million Africans did not go to work or not go to school that day. And the three things that the US capitalist system is afraid of from the African community are a general strike, urban rebellions, which are an extension of slave rebellions, and this African cultural historical reclamation movement that is growing by the minute, and they're trying to do everything they can to stop it. Rupert Murdoch tries to stop it by buying Birth of a Nation for $17.5 million. The Smithsonian tries to stop it by putting the CEOs of Bank of America and American Express on the board of directors of the museum, and Colin Powell, whose only contribution to our history and culture is to kill Africans in every corner of the world. He bombed Libya in 1986, which gave Barack Obama the inspiration to bomb Libya in 2011. And going Gaddafi real quickly, his commitment to having one currency is an extension of his plan in the 1970s for Africa to have one central television station. My father was the director of television in the eastern part of Nigeria. He went there to see him, and he talked about one central television station because he was looking at the role of media and the decolonization of the African mind. This was in the 1970s. And in the 1990s, the Washington Post revealed that the government of Moi in Kenya was training anti-Gaddafi troops that were living. And so they'd been trying to bring about regime change in Libya. And of course, Zimbabwe, I had the honor of being the U.S. correspondent to Zimbabwe's national newspaper, The Herald. And a few weeks ago, they had a forum at the U.S. Institute of Peace. Scariest building I've ever been to in my life, right across the street from the State Department. And they said, you know, Zimbabwe is winning the propaganda war. And Mugabe has been able to convince the world that the sanctions are the reason that there's a problem in the country, not negligence, not bad government. And you can even see now, Brother Rock, as our hearts go out to our people in Haiti for what they're dealing with. Southern Africa is experiencing its worst drought in 35 years. Mozambique has declared a red alert in the central and southern part of the country. South Africa, 8 of its 9 provinces, they've declared a national emergency. Lesotho, Namibia, Zimbabwe, and Botswana have all declared national emergencies. And you haven't seen this on the news anywhere. And the reason is because Southern Africa stands firmly behind Zimbabwe, wants to see the sanctions lifted, supports the land reclamation program in Zimbabwe, because 67% of Southern Africa depend on agriculture for their livelihood. So when we're talking about food security, when we're talking about self-determination, and lastly, always bringing it back here, at the beginning of this year, the governor of Illinois, Ron, the Republican, he said that they were shutting down all the public schools in Illinois. And he said that he was going after Chicago State University first, which is a PBI, not an HBCU. For those who'll be watching this, a PBI is a predominantly black institution, which did not start out with the intent of educating us, but based on the change and the shift in demographics, we became a majority. And in Chicago, while you're hearing about all these murders, 50 schools were closed by Rahm Emanuel, President Obama's first chief of staff, and the Secretary of Education during the majority of his tenure as president, Arne Duncan. Before he came and took that job, he was the CEO of public schools in Chicago. And the reason I bring that up is because 60% of the students at Chicago State University were first generation graduates, and they had to close it right after spring break. Now, Zimbabwe, under these crippling sanctions, has a 97% literacy rate, and there's a university 3 hours outside of Harare called Midland State University. Florida A&M has 14,000 students, Howard 13,500, North Carolina A&T in that neighborhood. In Gweru, Midland State University, 25,000 undergraduates, 3,500 graduates in a country that is sanctioned, yet they want to politicize human rights. What human right is more basic than education? And Libya was the only country in Africa where education was free for the people. So when we take a look at, if you're not concerned, we'll tell you what Malcolm said in Selma in 64. He said, to understand Mississippi, you must understand the Congo. If you're not concerned about the Congo, you're really not concerned about Mississippi. So there are a whole lot of Oscar Grants, a whole lot of Eric Garners, a whole lot of Trayvon Martins, a whole lot of Freddie Grays that lay dead in the sand of Libya. And if we're not going to connect our resistance inside the borders of the U.S. to dealing with that, then we're not serious about our liberation.
Standing applause once again. As I hear you talking about that, talking about the connection of the mayors to the police, I remember that it was the mayor, Wilson Good, in Philadelphia, who gave the orders to drop the bombs on the organization. And I remember I was spending a lot of time in Camden, New Jersey. I was representing a fighting man in Atlantic City. We were over in Philadelphia a lot. And I remember seeing a newscast where he defiantly addressed his critics, saying that he would do it again and again and again. The relationship of the mayors with police forces, that's an example. If you ever want to bring up, if you ever want to identify that relationship and its horrific consequences, that is one that we would talk about. As we talk about, to hear you speak on, you know, the international scene, and to come back to the film and how it wraps up, the brilliance of how it wraps up with Michael Jackson, "They Don't Really Care About Us." Very, 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 very powerful. Michael Jackson's struggles with the oppressor. His Michael Jackson had a consciousness that is underappreciated. Yes. People don't really know about it because he was put forward in a number of untoward kind of ways. But there was a certain consciousness that he had where he fought with the power structure. He fought white supremacy. He understood that he was a pain victim of white supremacy. So to have that "We Don't Really Care About Us" and to hear sort of him sing that song with a guttural resonance, it is because he felt that hurt and pain very, very deeply. He felt that violation. He felt that oppression. To then finish it with Sam Cooke, "A Change Is Going to Come." You know, it reminds me of Martin Luther King and his comment that the moral arc of the universe is long, but it bends towards justice. And we see so many situations that it oftentimes without a resourcefulness of, with the resource of strength of mind, of understanding history, that it can cause one to give up hope. But as Cornel West, I heard him say just a little bit ago, "In spite of evidence to the contrary, I remain a prisoner of hope." And seeing this film and just having this moment in this room is encouraging. It gives a sense of hope. Again, I'm gonna, at the risk of repeating myself, because to me, it is so extraordinarily meaningful. This film, I would say to each person in here that had, whatever your sphere of influence is, get this film into and before your friends. And tell them to put it before their friends and let their kids see it. Because the power of it can be absolutely transformative. And, you know, man, I find myself really repeating, Obi, because I'm so impressed with the work that was done. And sort of, yes, the kids did it, but and the understanding of what has been your commitment to creating a mindset of liberation and developing liberators. You know, universities are supposed to develop, you know, they say their mission is to develop leaders. Well, I've examined that, you know, what does leader mean? You know, because if you're leading an American Express, and your company is contributing to greater problems in the world, then you're not a liberator. That for
our people, liberation really needs to be at the forefront. This film is about liberating.
Thank you. Well, what it is what we have to understand is we must make, when we go, we must make resistance the cornerstone of our narrative. And we must go from, as Kwame Ture used to talk about all the time, we must go from mobilization to organization, which means we will go from family to community, and we will go from victimization to resistance. So if we focus on the modern day civil rights movement, the first image in our mind won't be police spraying water hoses on us. It'll be the marches, it'll be the brainstorming, it'll be the planning, it'll be celebrating all of those organizations and recognizing what we did as a collective. Part of this process in the 1990s, we had a divide. There were those who focused on leadership, but it was a capitalist model of leadership. And there were those who focused on historical responsibility. Historical responsibility simply was to expand on the work of those who came before you and correct the positive things and correct their mistakes at the same time. And right now I say that because what we have is we have there are two type of people who are blessed to have platforms at their disposal. They are those who are genuinely trying to build a movement, and they are those who are trying to build their reputations at the expense of our movement. We use the same lingo, we use the same historical references, but the only thing that distinguishes us is our body of work. And what that means is, as we are, Kwame Nkrumah said it best, he said, practice without thought is blind, thought without action is empty. So the struggle to have that harmonious balance between theory and practice is a serious challenge. But when we look at our organizations past and present, we should not only look at the words of the spokespeople, because our history, for all intended purposes, has been reduced to the autobiographies of charismatic spokespeople. But the work those organizations have done, that's what we're not focusing on. This is why, and as a matter of fact, this narrative that treats the 1960s the way Christians treat the Garden of Eden in the Bible, we have to do away with that. Because, like, for example, I was watching an episode of Unsung about Dick Gregory, you mentioned him earlier, and someone asked the question, has any artist ever given up their career for the movement? And I said, oh, they don't know who Paul Robeson is, obviously. And I was talking to someone in Selma the other day, and they were talking about the Lowndes County Freedom Organization. And I told them, oh, Du Bois was working in Lowndes County in 1906.
Let me jump in here.
Okay.
Because you talk about the leadership and correcting. The reason I wanted to jump in is because you mentioned Marcus Mosiah Garvey. Mm-hmm. In 1919, 1920, 1921, and 1922, had an organization which worldwide had 6 million members. No text, no email, no cell phone, none of the technology of today. And when we juxtapose what he did, the worldwide impact that he had, the number of people that were involved in his organization, which was for the advancement, make no mistake about it, for the advancement. If we do and reflect today, what has been heretofore in this last century and a half, our inability to be able to duplicate what he did with all of the advances that we had, that's a look in the mirror that should be extremely alarming.
Well, one good thing about his approach, and this is very important to talk about, he had 50 chapters in Cuba, for example. And the fact that now, and this is where it comes in, and this is what we're organizing a Global African Children's Festival on December 9th. It was originally supposed to be Saturday, but to do it the way that it's supposed to be done, we want it to be done correctly. We're going to be organizing an activity in Washington, D.C. at St. Stephen's Incarnation Church. We'll be doing our play about Thomas Sankara and Kwame Nkrumah. Farafina Khan Drumming and Dancing Ensemble will be there. Muhammad University of Islam will be there. Levine School of Music will be there. But we're asking Africans all over the world that work with children to have an event at the same time we're having an event. And so far, Brother Rock, we've gotten commitments from people in Baltimore, in Philadelphia, in New Jersey, in Montgomery, in Selma, Alabama, in Atlanta, Georgia, in New Orleans, in Chicago, in Oakland, in Portland, in Dallas. Outside of U.S. borders, we met with some people in Colombia. We had a meeting at the Cuban embassy the other day. They were smiling from ear to ear. We're looking at Venezuela. We're looking at El Salvador. We're looking at the Congo. We're looking at Senegal. We're looking at Liberia. And this is one, so this is the way we want to get back to that. Now, this whole, and part of this process is we want to, of course we say we're Africans, not African Americans, but at the same time, we must analyze America properly. We must give the Democrats and the Republicans their definition of America back and tell them thanks but no thanks. It is too fascist, it is too white supremacist for us. It is so fascist and white supremacist, it would make Hitler and Mussolini envious if they were still here. So we're saying that we're going to use the geographical definition of America, which enables us to connect with 190 million Africans in this hemisphere who are in places like Brazil, 190 million, in places like Colombia, South America, 11 million, who are in Cuba, in Panama, in Jamaica, all over because of the first form of public transportation, the slave ship. So we definitely want to begin to organize that way. So imagine if every time we march about the police question or the fact that 800 of our children are dropping out every day, we can ensure that we can have demonstrations in front of U.S. embassies all over this hemisphere. People often forget that during the first March on Washington in 1963, Maya Angelou, Julian Mayfield, Alice Wyndham, Preston King, W. Alpheus Hinton, that repatriate community in Ghana, they demonstrated on the U.S. Embassy in Ghana at the same time we were doing it here. So there's no reason why we can't get back to that type of organizing. And what it is we have accepted since 1965 that voting is the only outlet of political expression. Now, if you say it's the most effective outlet, that's something that we can intelligently and humbly and objectively discuss with each other. But if you say, oh, it's the only outlet, then that conveys a message and propagates a notion that grassroots organizing is no longer an adequate vehicle. And we know in a war like the war that we're in for our liberation and self-determination, the job of the enemy is to take away the best weapons you have at your disposal. But at this moment, we would rather show people than discuss. We would rather practically. So we're going to show people on December 9th, right after you've had the elections, right after they've had the State of the Black Union in Newark, right after, 1 year after the 20th anniversary of the first Million Man March, the NAACP.
Music, move into it, put a fist up, prove it to us. This is much more than music to us. This is beauty and strife. And if you know about the music, then you know about life. This is movement, music, move into it, put a fist up, prove it to us. This is much more than music to us. This is beauty and strife. And if you know about the music, then you know about life.
Word is
any kind of activity that takes place on the floor of the Congress or the Senate, that's the government. Any kind of dilly-dallying, that's the government. Any kind of pussyfooting, that's the government. Any kind of act that's designed to delay, or deprive you and me right now of getting full rights, that's the government that's responsible.